Thank you for giving me opportunity to speak here. I'm not going to talk about robotics. I'm not going to talk about AR, VR, big data. I'm going to talk about design for another billion. The people who are not so privileged, as designers, what best we can do for them. And so I thought of this, taking experience of design for social and sustainable development. And what the tribal woman you see here, the garments and jewelry which they are wearing is not designed by any fashion designers, it's not designed by any jewelry designers, meaning that in our culture, especially in China and India, there is so much of wealth of tacit knowledge which exists, and how we can bring it to the classroom and then see that how we can make a better life for another billion. So I would like to talk about India, and there are lots of similarity between India and China. So India is a very diverse country. India is culturally vibrant, geographically diverse, economically layered, and strategically global. Now, when I say economically layered, that there are people who may be 500 richest in the world, but there are people who are really struggling to get the two times meal. Means when they say that inequality, India is the second highest in the world where the difference between rich and poor, where the first one is South Africa, second one is India. So I think somewhere how design can really bring closer this inequality and see that we are less unequal between the rich and poor. So, similar to China, 5,000-year-old civilization, population over 1.25 now, spread over to 3,500 kilometers, I don't have to tell, but India probably it is the only country in the world where the Stone Age and Space Age coexist today. Just in the 500 kilometers difference, the Space Research Center, who is launching the rocket to Mars and just go 500 kilometers, people are still using bow and arrow and trying to living in a very rudimentary condition. This kind of diversity, I would say, is the fantastic thing for designers, because they get so much of inspiration with the diversity to do that. This multilingual, multicultural, socio-economic, cultural, all those variations are the great thing for students to really see that what best they can do in this diversity. So as I mentioned, the culturally it is so vibrant that even if people are poor, they are enjoying their life. And here one point I want to make, the money doesn't get you a joy of life. There are some other things which are there. So celebration of life, we have got only one life to live, and how we can really celebrate it, that is more important. So, India has been ruled by many, many countries. So that's why we can divide India in many Indias. There are many Indias within Indias. So traditional India, which was 1,000 years ago, if you look into that, what were the focal point on India, then there was a Mughal India when the Mughals invaded and they ruled India for 500 years. Then there was a British India. They ruled India for 200 years. The good part is that they brought English in our country. And then there was independence in 1947. And 1980s, that the post-globalization, the global India, which we are living in. So traditional India, where the togetherness of art and culture was very much nurtured. Mughal India, Taj Mahal, you must have heard about that. Lots of architecture and Persian textile had come during that time. So a lot of knowledge had come during that period. That's the Taj Mahal. The colonial India, where this entire British Raj, British culture came in. And then there was a post-independent, more socialistic model where the big projects, small handicrafts, cottage industry, small, medium, and large-scale industry, a license, like there were limited licenses were given just to see that this socialistic model that everybody gets equal opportunity at that time, and then the global India, which I don't have to tell that all retail boom and joint venture and IT revolution and open economy, everything is coming. But, and similar situation is in China also, there is an agrarian India where the 70% people live on agriculture. And there is an industrial ethos, so agrarian ethos and Indian ethos. And somewhere we have to see that where industrial ethos, lot of focus on the design thinking is going in, are we really looking into the agrarian society, which is in fact 70% part in India who are living, is there any focus on design in this area? So there are advantages of agrarian ethos and there are advantages of industrial ethos, but in nutshell, that when we are breaking away and going to a small family system, there is a degree of insecurity. And once you move from joint family to individual family, I, me, myself, and hoarding mentality comes, and we just try and buy that the feeling that in education that you are just continuously buying things without knowing what is happening. The market is exploiting the situation. They say that the supermarket works on two principles, fear and greed. And they say that 50% sale is going on. The fear is that tomorrow it may not be available. Greed is that 50% sale is there. You don't need, but still you are just getting things. And that is the way industry more on I, me, myself is working. While agrarian ethos is more sharing kind of things where we are together, that concept is there. But in agrarian ethos, you see, there was a timelessness in product development. There was a name to the product and face to the product. If somebody is making a textile, it's for some kind of ceremonial thing which will pass from mother to daughter to granddaughter and it will go on. There is a life and emotions connected with that. Similarly, the products which were created by the artisans, they're lifeless, 200 years, 300 years, not, but they are very valuable things. But in the industrial ethos, that life is gone. In fact, the life is built that you have to throw your mobile after 2 months or 2 years to buy another one. And there is a multiplicity, mass production, replace, substitute, better, cheap, dispose, throw away, dispense, no use. These are the things which we all, in fact, designers have made a lot of money by just generating another product, another kind of things, and then taking it forward. The other aspect which is happening in this whole global kind of thing, we are having a cultural loss somewhere. The national identity or the type of things which you visit are totally replaced by all this multinational brand, whether it's McDonald's, you go to Delhi, you go to Chennai, you go to Beijing, you go to anywhere else. The malls and streets are losing their complete culture and they are becoming homogeneous. So the heterogeneity and the beauty of that culture which exists is getting into heterogeneity and we are losing our cultural values very fast with this. So control, alter, delete culture is there. If things are not used, just throw it. And there is a psychological obsolescence deliberately built into the product, feeling of inadequacy in product life cycle, which is very short and that you have to buy another one. But the impact of this use and throw is happening is that we started even in human relationship using and throwing. There is no such sustainable aspects which are coming up. Anything which is useful to us, we keep it, including friendship, if they are not useful. These are just a hypothesis which is there that it has an impact on emotions as well. So advantage of design, the advent of design education, now I'm going to talk about my school, which was set up in 1961 with these two great design thinkers, Charles and Ray Eames. And they really talked that what kind of design institute India should have in 1958 India reports. It's online and I would request if you can read this actually. So this is the school. We celebrated just 50 years. But this school is very interesting. Learning by doing and learning from the field. These two ethos they brought in. They said it is not just going to be a classroom teaching. Education, research, training, incubation, publication, promotion, protection. All these activities will happen, and the student will do research, will do training, will do incubation, do publication, promotion, protection. All these departments are there. So the live project, they get chance to do that. But the interesting part is learning from the field. The craftsman is also professor at NID. We invite a person to talk about what are the traditional way by which the textile printing is done in the classroom. So this knowledge is coming from the tacit route. Another knowledge is through the syllabus route. It comes into the classroom, which provides innovative solution, enhanced design knowledge, and improvement of quality of life. And this is the way, I think, which one is going through. So what are we doing in understanding the local needs, solutions, materials, identifying user characteristics, sustaining tradition and modernity both? One is not talking about AR, VR. We are talking about that also. I'm just saying it's not just tradition and craft. We are talking about AR, VR, but we are also talking about handicraft and the traditional knowledge. Use of contemporary knowledge and technology. So I will go through the classroom projects, what we are doing. You see that Mahatma Gandhi and Nelson Mandela, these two great thinkers, which they have given a lot of, they have worked for the underprivileged people to great extent. They devoted their life for the rights, and the difference between what we do and what we are capable of doing would suffice to solve most of the world's problem. And I think their wisdom was, we have to really take it to the next level. Gandhiji also said that there is enough for people's need, but not enough for the greed. And that need, which we need to take it forward. The social development. We adopted village almost like 50 years ago. We adopted a village where the management school and design school. And we said that let us bring the management point of view and design point of view, and how we can really create a rural university which will empower the social fabric of that. India has a caste system, upper caste, lower caste. Lower caste do not have many privileges, and that is sometimes great deal of exploitation, and how design can help in empowering that lower caste to come to the equal level. So the two communities were living there. One was working with the leather, and leather is considered to be with dead animals, so they are untouchable. Another community was the weaver, who were weaving the rugs, and the design intervention, the faculty members start going there. But we focused on that we will not try to temper their ecosystem. We will certainly look into sociological point of view, anthropological point of view, and see that within their network, the way they are processing leather, the way they are doing hardware, and the way they are making other things within that ecosystem, how we can develop these products. And we started working with them. And we developed many products, actually. So now here, some of these designs which have been made, it's become such a big hit now, even after 50 years, because they're organic leather. There is no chemicals are used. And today, they are exporting it after 50 years of design. These are the rugs which they are making, which is going all over the world now. And what the lady in 1976, when started project, that will not show her face to the people who are coming outside, and the male folks become so looking, the smiling thing. I think this is the difference design has done for social empowerment. And I think this is what which we really need to look into, that how we can empower people, give dignity to them, give confidence to them with your work in this whole process. Where they were not allowed to fetch the water from the well, because only upper caste were using, they were empowered to use the well and fetch the water. Woman empowerment. We started sharing our skills with African countries. We said we have done a lot of work in social sector. Why not we take it? And three countries we took, Zimbabwe, Ethiopia, and Ghana. We went to these countries, worked with the craftswoman, our students, you can see, and they brought them to NID in India, and also taught them some of these processes. And then the product which you can see, which have come up, and here the economic empowerment has come 5-6 times more than that. These are the other from Zimbabwe, Ghana, the very fine weaving they have. And this is Ghana, that you can see the new designs which have come up. Sorry, the slides are taking more time. The new products which were developed, this was Ethiopia, and this is the group. You can see me, the students and all the crafts people who are there. This was in Ghana. And we are doing a lot of work with the crafts people in the classroom. This is a natural fiber. It is also very strong in Asian countries. And we said that how we can really bring it to our lab and start working on newer product. And jute actually is considered to be very dirty fiber, jute. And it has completely changed the economy of this, where we started using it in a fashion bag. This fiber and the products were created, and they got, in fact, some of the bags have got, this is a student who developed the range of bags, some of the bags have got G mark from Japan. Recognizing legacy, I think it's a very, very important aspect that classroom and student must go and document the traditional practices. It's a fast disappearing knowledge in country like China and India. There's not much the next generation would know, but we must document our legacy for the future researchers. That will be a bigger wealth to understand whether it is to do with the practices or jewelry or garments or whatever. So some of these, Northeast India, we have documented very simple, frugal looms, where beautiful things which they are making, and we have documented all. Craft practices in different parts, students are going and trying to create contemporary design, which we are also, which is happening in everywhere. But what we thought, that if a fashion designer is working with the craftsperson on the ramp, the craftsperson and the fashion designer walk together. And this is one of that experiment which we did, where this entire showcase, the fashion designer and the craftsperson, they co-created. And the co-creation is important. It is not that only fashion designer is taking the mileage of creation, it's a craft person who should also take thing. Bamboo, in fact, it so happened that one of our graduates started exporting in China some of the bamboo furniture, this particular one. And beautiful work he's doing. The other crafts, design intervention happened. But this is, again, very important area of lots of people are defecating outside, and Prime Minister is also making. So these are very mundane things, but they require cultural context, actually, and then you create something, so culturally they accept it. Because you see, as other presenters say, that you have to understand DNA of your system. So you can become a global leader on your own strength and not on borrowed strength. And you have to really look into what are your strengths, what kind of things which is in the DNA, and you will take it forward. Now, another big taboo related subject is this, the sanitary napkin. And they say that in India, that it's a young country, there are 500 million menstruating women are there. Out of 500, maybe 12% or 17% are using the disposable napkin. What happens to others? If they are using unhygienic ways by protecting themselves, there are lots of issues related with healthcare and all. And we said that we must talk about it. We must talk in the classroom. And we started working with this. The animation studio, we started making animation film. The textile person started doing some other things. So this was a animation film, became very famous actually. And then taking out the clothes from the cloth manufacturers and creating some kind of napkins. So this is again the student has created the work. So difficult situation, bringing it into the classroom and creating product. And the systems thinking. When we are talking about community-based interventions for rural maternity help, we cannot bring the city model in rural areas. We have to understand the ecosystem and understand the whole thing about this maternity help, where there's so many people are dying, how design can really help in that. Also the digitization, when the digital power is becoming such a big data is becoming, can we empower with the tablets to the village woman who can collect the data and give it to the... So you see that you are empowering the lady to work and feed the data. So then the healthcare can be properly taken. And there I feel that whole our AR, VR or computer, the fourth industrial revolution which we are talking about, remotest part can we provide the good health care? That should be our target sometime in the developmental activities. Public spaces, extreme situation. It is so difficult to design interiors of public road where this 5 times more people are traveling. This was the project which we did. And this kind of project, I think the technology really makes the difference. The $10 worth, the knee joint has been created. MIT University was involved. And these are the real things which one can really bring into the design school. And this was one of the 50 best innovations by Times. Then lots of classroom project with the Braille mobile phone or multi-purpose wheelchairs. And also working environment for the people who are doing really very difficult work, like the coal miners. Can you do something with those miners? And hand tools. Big area for hand tools where the salt workers, when they are collecting salt, in a very difficult situation they work, and can you develop some good tools for them? Railway workers, the railway line workers, when they are working, their tools are really harming them to the great extent. Grassroots innovation. We started collecting these innovations from the grassroots. Farmers are solving their problems. Let us take it to the classroom and work together and create some of these small things. And these are the classroom project which we have taken from Loom, where the new systems was not really making her earn her bread. So we took those cloth, created the new garments, and then started looking into national design policy, because I was looking after the India Design Council. We brought in national design policy. We launched India Design Market with Japan, and we started selecting good design selection system. And you can see that in Japan also we are taking this. All right, thanks very much actually to Japan, who have helped us in establishing this. Design clinic. I think this is something where the small and medium enterprises, which is the backbone of Indian economy, how 26 million MSMEs can be helped with the design, where the 45% total export is happening. All over the country, working with small scale industry, students have gone and worked on the projects. You can see that faculty and students are looking into the projects and coming out with the simple projects which are making tremendous economic things. These are the products which have come out from small scale industry. So, the future challenges design need to tackle in Indian context: education, sanitation, security, healthcare, empowering women and children, urban migration. Migration is the biggest threat which is there, and environment issues which we need to really look into. So, smart village. People talk about a smart city, but I would say that we must talk about the smart villages. How we can make villages smart? Because there has to be stability, otherwise they will go out. If they will not have possible employment, what will they do? Morality, if the dignity is not given, then they will not stay there. Ability, skill to survive, respectability, as I said, the dignity, and tradability, they can do business with other part. I think these are the aspects if we can focus. It's not only smart city, we can also make smart villages. So migration has all these issues: dissatisfaction, unhappiness, lack of employability, lack of education and healthcare, inadequate nutrition, agrarian crisis, and resource crunch. These are the reasons by which people are migrating. And if this migration, which is the city of Bombay, is that looking for the employment, you see that one side, the rich, and another side, the poor, almost 40% people are living in the slum, which is a big threat actually. But if you have to really resolve this, these are the wicked problem. These are require critical design thinking. And I think with the systems thinking, such kind of issues can be resolved and can be taken. So we cannot become what we need to be by remaining what we are. Thank you very much. And I think I have taken... Thank you.